parents, our Sunday school teachers, the pastors who have come before, people from church history who have passed the faith to us. And as you were coming in, we asked you to write down the name of a Christian, maybe your family member whom you know who have died in the Lord. And of course, there's also our heritage from inheritance from church history, people like Wesley, people like St. Paul, St. Peter, and so on. We put their names there to remember that as we come before Him in communion service, we have the fourth theme, okay? And the fourth theme is that we come not alone, but with a communion of saints. Some of you have lost your loved ones. Pastor B lost his mother recently. And our brother David's father, David from Ghana, his father passed away this morning. But they are now with the Lord. And they are surrounding us like the cloud of witnesses, cheering us on that we will live for Him. And this is in Hebrews 12, where it says, we are surrounded by a cloud of witnesses. And so every communion, I remember those who have died in the Lord. I mean, of course, you can remember other times, but especially at communion, at one particular part of communion where we say, therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, this is the 8:30 service, we laud and magnify thy holy name, evermore praising thee and singing, holy, holy, holy. So we join our parents, our grandparents, those who have been in, who are in the Lord right now. And we sing together with them in praising God, the church on earth and the church in heaven. So we're going to sing this song, God and man at table are set down. We're going to remember those who have gone before us and all the others who come with us, even as we come before the Lord's table.
Now before your very eyes unfold the wonders all so long ago foretold. God and man at table are set down. Elders, martyrs, all are falling down. Prophets, patriarchs are gathering. Just long to see now man has found. God and man at table are set down. Who is this who spreads the victory feast? Who is this who makes our warring cease? Jesus, risen Savior, Prince of Peace. Repentant publicans are drawing near. Wayward sons came home without a fear. God and man at table are set down. God and man at table are set down.
I want to invite you to pause a while and give thanks to God for those who have passed on in the Lord, those who have passed on the faith to us, our family members, our friends, even the missionary, like in this church, there was a missionary who served and has died, Annabelle, and the others whom we have loved. Remember them and thank God that they are actually worshiping with us right now and encouraging us on. Hear the words of invitation to the Lord's table. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. I'm going to invite you to confess your sins before God and one another, but before we do that, I'd like you to ask the question, who is invited to the table? Who kneels next to us when we come to communion? Is it our friends? Or is it people whom we can't stand? Would some of the people who come forward with us be the people that we have difficulties with? Or someone from a different color, race, caste, gender, status in life? Remember we sang just now, beggars, lame, and harlots also here. Repentant publicans are drawing near. Wayward sons come home without a fear. God and man at table are set down. I'm going to ask Wendy to read that which is in the box.
Paul's difficult warning that we can eat and drink at the Lord's table to our damnation has been the object of centuries of speculation. One way of eating and drinking to our own damnation may be to accept food from the Lord's table without making sure that there is food on other tables. The usual interpretation of sacrament goes like this. We go through our daily, dreary, ordinary routines, and every once in a while, there is an unusual or extraordinary event, a baptism or a Eucharist with a special meaning. That, for the moment, intrudes the presence of the unusual, the extraordinary, into the daily routine. And after that, we settle back into the routine, glad for our momentary respite. But surely it is the other way around. The sacramental moments are meant to be the normative moments that show us what ordinary life is meant to be and usually is not. On this reading, it is all of life that is included in the real moments, the sacramental moments. The Lord's Supper is not meant to be the extraordinary meal, but the ordinary one, the meal that is the model for all other meals. The way bread is shared on this occasion is the way bread is meant to be shared on all other occasions. The dynamics of the occasion say to us, you can't afford to pay for the meal? Come anyway, there is no charge. You don't usually meet the sort of people who are gathered here? Come anyway, for there are no distinctions here between upper and lower classes, rich and poor, male and female. Everyone is on the same footing, and the equality is an equality of need. You haven't done anything to earn the right to be here? Come anyway, for neither has anyone else. And when someone replies that it isn't really like that, since at many tables, women cannot yet preside, or minorities aren't really welcome, let it be said that such a recognition, loudly noted, is itself an important step on the way to closing the gap between what is and what is meant to be.
So now we look at the theme of Holy Communion as a converting ordinance, that communion is the norm by which we judge how we live. So if at this table your helper comes and kneels before the table with you, then at home, when we have our meal, we do not eat our food first and then leave the leftovers to her. It means that when we work, we treat everybody the same and not talk to people perhaps of a different race in a different way. You see, communion is a converting ordinance. The Lord confronts us here with his equality of love. So I'm going to ask you to look at the theme on page 7. I'm going to ask you to read it with me so that you remember what the themes are that we looked at. Okay, the first, let's read together. Christ is present. It is a meal of joy. Communion of saints, our forebears in the faith are with us, inspiring us, cheering us on as the cloud of witnesses. And they worship God together with us. We remember them and give thanks. Communion is a converting ordinance. It should change us, our values, our attitudes, our action. People we like or don't like, people we look down upon, they all share the same table with us. Am I at peace with them? Am I treating them with respect? What changes do I have to make? Let's have a few moments as we think of what we need to do.